My name is Kate Rhéaume-Bleue, aka Dr. Kate. I am a naturopathic, doctor of naturopathic medicine, and an author and an educator, a host of Global Health Factors, and author of Vitamin K2 and the Calcium Paradox: How a Little Known Vitamin Can Change Could Save Your Life and Change Your Life, certainly. Who here? So let me get an idea of what drew you out tonight. Who came because they have concerns about bone health? Okay. How about heart health concerns? Cholesterol, should you or shouldn't you take the meds? What's normal, what's healthy? Okay, who just, their wife dragged them out and that's really all the, yeah, just a few of those? Okay, that's fine. You'll learn something too. Okay, how about, let's do a poll. Who is taking vitamin D? Okay, I'm taking vitamin D. Who's taking calcium supplements? Okay. Not about half, not sure. Who is, you know, not sure, shouldn't I? Okay, so, all right, so for those of you taking calcium and or vitamin D, I have some good news and some bad news. What do we want first? Bad news, okay. It's just a little bit of bad news and lots of good news. So we'll get the bad news out of the way with first, and then we can all go home feeling good. In April of last year, so just about a year ago, when I was completing the manuscript for this book, the studies came out that said that women who take calcium supplements have 20 to 30% more heart attacks and stroke than those who don't. Yeah, that's pretty shocking. So who heard about those studies? Did anybody not hear about those studies? Okay, yeah, so even lots of people even didn't hear about those studies. As surprising and as shocking as they were, they almost didn't get, in a sense, as much media coverage or attention as they should. These weren't the first studies to say this, by the way. They were the third set of studies to report the same trend. Earlier studies hadn't taken into account vitamin D, so they were criticized. So they redid it and they said, with or without vitamin D, we see this trend. Other research groups have shown the same thing. And that is, in a sense, so confusing that the studies maybe didn't get as much attention as they should have, because, wow, that's a big deal, because everybody is taking vitamin D and calcium. We've been doing that for years because our doctors have been telling us to do that. Even the most conservative doctor, who won't tell you to take a multivitamin, will tell you to take calcium and vitamin D. And based on this research, these researchers said, well, women should just stop taking calcium. Okay, that's even more shocking because, first of all, everybody's been taking calcium. What, have we been doing harm? And if so, what kind of harm? And is this reversible or not? And what, if we just stop, will that solve the problem? And then the flip side of that is we're taking these things for a very good reason. And by the way, gentlemen, this equally applies to you. I'll get to you in a moment. But we're taking these things for a very good reason. We know absolutely that calcium and vitamin D help improve our bone density, which helps with osteoporosis. And you might say, well, osteoporosis isn't nearly as serious as heart disease, heart attacks, and strokes. But the fact is that 30% of people who suffer a hip fracture will die within 1 year of that injury due to complications of that injury. So hip fractures can be fatal. And of the people who survive, 75% will never live or walk independently again. So that is an important factor in decline with age. So it's not something that we can just overlook that simply. And on the flip side, we don't want to sacrifice our heart health for our bone health. So what the heck do we do? It's very confusing. And because it's so confusing, those studies, in a sense, didn't get as much attention as they should, because what the heck do we do? It seems like it's a no-win situation. And by the way, the reason why this applies equally to the gentleman in the audience is because, okay, the studies were done on women because women, we take more calcium supplements because we have greater concerns around our bone health. However, heart disease, heart attacks and strokes caused by this calcification of the arteries that leads to a blocking or occluding of the arteries, otherwise known as hardening of the arteries or atherosclerosis, that is the number one killer of both men and women, whether or not you take calcium supplements. So this problem applies to everybody. And so that's serious concern for all of us. So this is something I call the calcium paradox. This is this paradoxical situation in which we need calcium in the body, absolutely, but we need it to be in the right places. And if it's missing from certain areas like the bones, that's a problem. Instead, if it's building up in other areas, because what was happening in these studies, people were taking calcium And some of the calcium that wasn't getting into the bones was finding its way, lining the arteries, leading to hardening of the arteries, leading to heart attacks and strokes. And so, yes, it's absolutely true that calcium can get into the wrong places in the body, but it's not calcium's fault. And if we only ever look at calcium and just at calcium, more or less as we've been doing, we will continue to be confused and we will never be able to come to a meaningful answer. In other words, asking, are calcium supplements safe, is the wrong question to be asking, because we'll never be able to properly answer that or really come to some meaningful information, because it's, yeah, calcium gets in the wrong places, but calcium isn't to blame. It didn't end up there on its own, and it didn't get there by accident. So calcium, as you likely know, is a mineral, and minerals are literally tiny little rocks, microscopic rocks, essentially. That's what minerals are. And as you know, rocks are not especially dynamic. They don't get up and move around on their own. How the body moves minerals around is with fat-soluble vitamins. So specifically, for example, the reason why we all take vitamin D with our calcium is vitamin D helps us absorb more calcium from the intestines. Vitamin D does all kinds of other things for our health, lots of health benefits, and it even does other things for our bone health, but very simply helps us absorb more calcium, which can be a good thing, except that once the calcium is absorbed, vitamin D has no control over where it goes. So some of that calcium will find its way into your bones for the better, but some of it, as these studies are showing, will find its way into the arteries of the heart, leading to heart attack, and the brain, leading to stroke. Inappropriate calcifications can exist anywhere in the body, in the aorta, the carotids, outside the cardiovascular system. You can have heel spurs and bone spurs and kidney stones and all kinds of things. We'll touch on all of these. And it turns out that the nutrient that governs where calcium goes once it's been absorbed is a little known fat-soluble vitamin called vitamin K2. It works with vitamin D to move calcium around the body, and it specifically will, how vitamin K2 works is it activates two sets of proteins in the body. One set of proteins, once it's activated by vitamin K2, will take calcium and guide it into your bones and teeth where you want it. The other set of proteins, once it's activated by vitamin K2, those proteins will go and find calcium where it's not supposed to be, places like arteries, and actually not just prevent, but even remove calcium from those areas. So that is essentially how vitamin K2 puts calcium back into its place. So we're going to talk a little bit about how this works and then about how we've overlooked it for so long, how we're just hearing about it now, and a number of health concerns that are implicated along the way. So sometimes I do a version of this talk that's called The Truth About Cholesterol. Because when it comes to heart health, the whole story for decades has been all about cholesterol, right? Cholesterol, cholesterol, eat to lower your cholesterol, have your cholesterol measured, if it's high, take medications to lower it, et cetera, all this thing about cholesterol. And yet in these studies, we have individuals who are taking calcium supplements, didn't affect their cholesterol, and they're having 20 to 30% more heart attacks and strokes. So what's happening there? Well, it turns out that 50% of people who have heart attacks have normal cholesterol levels at the time of their heart attack and no history of ever having had high cholesterol. So, what does that mean? Well, high cholesterol may be an important red flag for your risk of heart disease if you have it, but if you don't have high cholesterol, that doesn't say anything about your risk of heart disease because you're just as likely to have a heart attack. And that's because what heart disease is this presence of calcium-laden plaque in the arteries. And that can be there whether cholesterol is high or not. Now, for certain individuals, men in particular, between the ages of 20 and 60, having high cholesterol, certain types, what we call the bad cholesterol when it's oxidized, that can certainly increase your risk for having this plaque. But for women, the correlation between cholesterol and heart disease is not great. In other words, having high cholesterol isn't a great predictor of whether or not you'll develop heart disease. For people over the age of 60, here's not something you don't hear every day, but in fact, in the last year, three studies have come out to say for over the age of 60, elevated cholesterol is associated with a lower risk of both heart disease and dementia. And so this is really, to a certain extent, we've been led astray in just focusing on cholesterol for so long. So certainly in the book, I talk about cholesterol, helping to understand it better, when it's a concern, when it's not. And but more importantly, we want to put into perspective what heart disease is. So for these people, for the 50% of people who are having heart attacks and never had high cholesterol, what's going on there? Well, the same thing as those ones who have high cholesterol. Typical example, you know, 50-year-old man, he seems like Mr. Super Fit and Healthy, exercises, eats right, jogs, all this stuff, and then he has a big heart attack. Last person you'd expect. But the fact is that this individual had a heavy plaque and calcium burden, even though their cholesterol was normal. So how can that be? Well, we have an idea. Well, actually, let's talk about this first. You can actually test this. So let's say we're not going to focus so much on cholesterol as we've been doing, and arguably because there are medications to lower it. But let's say we're going to focus on the presence of the plaque in the arteries, what actually blocks the arteries. This can be measured. It's measured by something called a coronary artery calcification test, or calcium score or heart score test. And it's a specialized type of CT scan, a super fast CT scan, that can image the beating heart in still. And then it can measure the amount of calcium that's present in the three main arteries that feed the heart itself, the coronary arteries. It can quantify that amount of calcium and then present this to you as a score. And this score represents the quantity of calcium in the arteries. And the score has been found to be a better predictor of mortality than age. In other words, you're only as old as your arteries. So if you happen to be that 50-year-old individual, seems healthy, but has a heavy calcium burden, high likelihood of having a heart attack within 5 years of this test. It's not some sort of indistinct, your risk of heart disease, whatever that might mean, but no, it's your risk of having a myocardial infarction within 5 years of this test. On the flip side, if you're 60, 70, 80, or even 90 years old and have low calcium burden, low risk of having a heart attack within 5 years of this test. So it's not a crystal ball, but it's pretty close, and it's entirely based on the amount of calcium that's present in the arteries. For those of you who are interested in this, by the way, it is available in Toronto. Places like MedCam will offer this, costs you about $1,700. Or you can drive down to Buffalo. Buffalo MRI offers this for about $300 US. So you just go on Google Buffalo MRI, you can print off a requisition form, have your doctor sign it, and then drive down to Buffalo and get your scan. It's very quick. Excuse me. So we have an idea about, let's back up for a second, about how this hardening of the arteries happens. We tend to think that, okay, so there's some fatty material that circulates in the bloodstream, and there may be some damage that will calcify and harden. But that's actually not how this happens. It turns out that when plaque starts to develop, atherosclerotic plaque or heart disease plaque, hardening of the arteries, when that develops, it will incorporate calcium right from the beginning in a very consistent ratio of approximately 20%. 20% of the volume of the plaque will be calcium. It forms part of the structure of that plaque. So it doesn't get there by fluke. It's not because it's been there for a long time. If you have a little bit of calcium, or a little bit of plaque rather, you'll have 20% of that will be calcium. If you have a lot of plaque, proportionally more will be calcium, which is how tests like this can be so accurate. It's not there by fluke. And it turns out that the body has a number of ways to prevent the buildup of this plaque. And the body even has a couple of ways to reverse existing plaque. Now that sounds incredible because we tend to think of heart disease as, you know, we call it the silent killer, right? It's gonna just sneak up on us and get us, or it's not, and we're powerless over it, and you know, we don't really know what's going on. But that's actually not the case. The body has ways to deal with this, and plaque may grow and shrink over time, unbeknownst to us. And if you think about it, human beings have had to deal with calcium in our diets and in our environments for millennia, so it's not surprising that our body developed mechanisms to save us from it, to make sure it wasn't causing harm. And surely, you know, once upon a time, we know 100 years ago, heart disease wasn't anywhere as common as it was today, and it's not as common in certain cultures as it is here. So the body does have ways of dealing with this, but it relies on certain nutrients. So recently, scientists have concluded that of the mechanisms we have to deal with calcium, the single most important mechanism that the body has to deal with inappropriate calcium depends on a protein called MGP. MGP is a protein that's produced in the blood vessels in a number of areas in the body, and essentially it doesn't do a whole lot until vitamin K2 arrives on the scene and activates this protein. Then MGP will essentially develop claws, look for calcium, find calcium, grab it, and draw it out of where it's not supposed to be. This has been shown to reverse the presence of arterial plaque, calcification, and plaque. In animal studies, up to 50% of the volume of plaque in only 6 weeks. Human clinical trials, the most definitive ones, we've seen good results in small trials. The most definitive ones are ongoing right now. Preliminary results look excellent. The final results hopefully will be in June or very soon in this year. And, you know, these kinds of calcifications can happen, as I said before, in various areas of the body. In chapter 4 of my book, I have a case contributed by a cardiologist who's used vitamin K2 with vitamin D in his practice to decalcify heart valves, for example. This typically would be considered, previously would be considered to be absolutely impossible. You just need to replace the valve with open heart surgery. But he was able to restore calcified heart valves to normal, healthy valves. So this is absolutely possible to do, and possible to do with the kind of products that we have in this store on these shelves. So in my estimation, if scientists agree that this is the most important mechanism, but this mechanism is dependent on a particular vitamin, well, arguably that makes this vitamin the most important for heart health. So let's look a little bit about other aspects of how vitamin K2 moves calcium around. So the heart health thing is the side of the equation where calcium is and it shouldn't be. Then we have the side of the equation where calcium should be, but it's not. And that's osteoporosis. And this is the reason why we all started to take calcium supplements, for those of us who are doing this. Of course, osteoporosis is a condition in which, over time, our bones lose their mineral density. Normally, bones, throughout our lives, they're not static. They will break down a little bit and then build up a little bit, constantly being broken down and built up to maintain a certain amount of bone density. But if over time the breakdown process starts to exceed the buildup process, then we end up with bones that are porous and brittle and prone to fracturing. And the mineral that's missing here is primarily calcium. There's other minerals involved, phosphorus and a number of other things. But the big one, of course, is calcium. Bones are mostly made up of that. And so based on that, the thinking was, well, you're missing calcium in your bones, take a calcium supplement. Makes sense. So we did that, and a little bit helped a little bit. And so based on the fact that a little bit helped, then the recommendation was, well, then take more, and more, and more, and more. And now 1,200 and 1,500 and 2,000 milligrams of calcium are common recommendations. And that, again, is based on the idea of if a little is good, then more is better. But in keeping with that thinking, then if we just took enough calcium, we could cure osteoporosis. But you know, it doesn't work that way, right? Because it's not just about having enough calcium, eventually that will cram it into the bones. Again, it's about having the right amount of calcium and getting it where it's supposed to be. So we can look at cultures like the Japanese or Thai cultures that, you know, they don't drink milk, they don't eat dairy products, they don't have especially high calcium diets. But they happen to have a lot of vitamin K2 in their diets and very little osteoporosis. So vitamin K2 does a number of things for bone health. First of all, it activates a set of proteins, one in particular called osteocalcin. Osteocalcin, again, is made in the body, circulates, not doing a whole lot. And when vitamin K2 comes in, it will activate this. This will then take calcium once we've absorbed it and draw it into our bones and our teeth. So very, very important. vitamin K2 works with D in this sense. So when we take vitamin D, it actually causes our body to produce this osteocalcin. But again, the osteocalcin won't do a whole lot until K2 comes in. And so they really do work hand in hand. And if you've been taking vitamin D, you essentially are creating a greater demand in your body for and potential to benefit from vitamin K2. Vitamin K2 also works with vitamin D in other ways. K2 will slow down the bone breakdown process, and so that allows vitamin D's bone building process to catch up, so that helps maintain bone density as well. There's a number of ways that it's helpful for our bones. We know that osteoporosis becomes a greater concern in menopause. Men suffer from osteoporosis as well, but typically it doesn't affect them till a little bit later in life. But when hormone levels begin to decline, which they're supposed to, that's normal, that has been found to, or potentially found to, affect bone health negatively in three different ways. To make a long story short, vitamin K2 has been shown to compensate for each of those ways to counteract the bone loss seen at menopause. So that's quite remarkable. Okay, so at this point you may be thinking, you know, the benefits of vitamin K2 are quite well documented and easy to understand. This whole moving calcium around mechanism is simple enough. Activate proteins to put calcium in the right places or take it out of the wrong places. So if this is all so straightforward, how have we not heard about it until now? And that is a case, it turns out, because of a case of mistaken identity. So vitamin K2 technically was discovered back in the 1930s. But there's another form of the nutrient that sort of hogged the spotlight. So there's another form of vitamin K that you may have heard of or be familiar with. That's vitamin K1. And this comes from green leafy vegetables. As a matter of fact, when this nutrient was discovered, the K comes from the German word coagulation, because this nutrient was found to be beneficial or necessary for our blood clotting. So vitamin K1 comes from green leafy vegetables, necessary for our blood clotting. The people who discovered this won a Nobel Prize for their discovery, very, very important. And as easy as this is to get from our diet, blood clotting is far too important to be left to the whims of your diet, right? You can't afford to bleed to death because you haven't eaten salad this week. So the body develops a mechanism to recycle vitamin K1. So if you eat green leafy vegetables only once every 6 months, you will have plenty of vitamin K1 for your blood clotting because it will be reused and reused. It's very, very important. And so based on that, you know, researchers at the time, they saw, well, you know, vitamin K comes in this other form. They called it K2. And but they figured, K1, K2, same thing, they're blood clotting vitamins. And that was pretty much it. They didn't look any closer at vitamin K2 for decades. And a few misconceptions and assumptions were made. They figured, well, first of all, this is easy to get in your diet. It's rare to be deficient because we have this recycling mechanism. And if you're deficient, guess what? You're going to notice because you're going to start to bleed and it's going to be pretty obvious. And it turns out that those things aren't true about vitamin K2. It took many decades to realize that vitamin K2, in fact, does not participate in blood clotting. Its role is to move calcium around. It does not come from green leafy vegetables, not as easy to get in the diet. And we don't recycle it. Why not? Well, its role is in moving calcium around. That's important, but it's not life-threatening, right? You can suffer some bone density loss for a little while, decades even, or the plaques quietly building up in your heart, sometimes for a very long time, before it harms you. And so we never developed a mechanism to recycle this nutrient. So you can, in fact, become deficient in this if it's missing from your diet in as little as a week. And researchers in 2007 showed that most apparently healthy adults are in fact deficient in vitamin K2. And again, you might be thinking, well, if you can be apparently healthy and deficient in it, then who cares? But the key word here is apparently. You can't tell by looking at somebody that they're on their way to osteoporosis or that they're on their way to a heart attack or hardening of the arteries or any of these other concerns, cancer, diabetes, all of these things. Those may not be obvious for a long, long time. So by deficient, we mean that you don't have enough vitamin K2 to activate all the proteins to make sure calcium is always in the right places. So how did we get into this sorry state? It wasn't always like this with when it comes to K2. K2 used to be abundant in our diets, at least in the summertime in Canada. And that is because certain creatures, certain animals, can eat green leafy vegetables and convert the K1 from those green leafy vegetables into vitamin K2. As people, we don't do that very well. We can do it a little bit, but not a lot. But cows, chickens, pigs, any herbivore, a creature that's primarily herbivore, can do this. So when those animals are out on the pasture, then our diet, in the terms of things like butter and dairy products and eggs, are abundant in vitamin K2. As we pulled animals off the pasture, particularly since the 1950s, we essentially eliminated this nutrient from our diet. To confined and grain feeding, that will remove vitamin K2 from our diets. And that has paralleled a huge increase in cancer, heart disease, obesity, diabetes, and a number of other health concerns. And we call them the metabolic syndrome, all implicated with the lack of this nutrient. So getting back to grass-fed foods, I know there's a movement towards this anyway, small production, local, eat local, farmers markets, slow food, etc. And that will help restore our K2 levels to the extent that the animals are being locally grass-fed. But I also recognize the fact that it is not necessarily easy for all of us to be able to get enough of these foods all the time to meet our needs. So we're going to look at some other food sources, because fortunately there are a few other food sources too. Okay, so here we have some more food sources. So the grass-fed foods, we mentioned that. This one here, I need to move. Goose liver. Goose liver doesn't actually have to be grass-fed. For whatever reason, goose liver is very high in vitamin K2. And you're thinking, oh, geez, how much goose liver have I had recently? I know it's not something we eat a lot, but just to mention, there's a reason that it's very high in vitamin K2. Then we have certain fermented foods. So some bacteria will make this vitamin. So certain cheeses, even if the milk that went into the cheese wasn't grass-fed, didn't have any K2 in it, doesn't matter, the bacteria that makes the cheese will make this vitamin. So Gouda is actually the highest cheese that we know of, followed closely by Brie, that's a pretty high one as well. Now this was Dutch research, so maybe they were a little bit biased on the Gouda, but it's very high. So look at this list of foods so far. Egg yolks, cheese, butter, goose liver, and brie. What does that sound like?
High cholesterol.
High cholesterol, right? But we don't care so much about that. It sounds like the French diet though, right? You remember how for decades we're all on these horrible low-fat diets for our heart health, and still we wondered who's heart healthy. We looked around the world, the French have very low rates of heart disease. What are the French eating? Oh my God, the French. Look at what they're eating, these creamy sauces and the brie cheese and the goose liver pate, and we just couldn't make sense of it. We called it the French paradox, how the French could eat so much fat and have such low rates of heart disease. Oh, and they smoke like chimneys. They really should all be dead of heart disease, but they're not. So we decided, the French, they must have some kind of secret ingredient. What is it about? Ah, the red wine, French. They get to eat all these foods, and then they drink red wine, and that equals it out. Doesn't work quite as well for us somehow, but... And there's no doubt about the fact that red wine is heart healthy. It has heart health benefits, sure, but it won't clear out your arteries the way vitamin K2 does. If you look at this list of foods, you'll see that the fact is the French were simply stuffing themselves with the one vitamin that would simply clear out their arteries. And so, if you want to, people talk a lot about, or you read a lot about heart healthy snacks, like, There's chairs in the front here, by the way. Heart healthy snacks, have some carrot sticks and hummus, or have some apple slices and a low fat yogurt dip. No, have some brie cheese and a glass of red wine. Maybe some goose liver pate to go with that. That is the ultimate heart healthy snack. Works for the French, and now you know why. So I'm talking to my sister about this. She's a medical doctor, and she says, yeah, it makes perfect sense. You know, I've always loved brie. I've been skeptical of cholesterol meds. I stopped prescribing them years ago. She says, but what about the Japanese? Ah, the Japanese. They have a completely different diet, right? They don't eat any of this stuff. But yet they are also very heart healthy. Well, it turns out the Japanese have a special fermented food called natto. That's the last one here, N-A-T-T-O. And natto, this is natto. This is, these are soybeans. That's a little soybean there. And it's held together by gobs of this stringy, slimy, kind of sticky stuff. And this was a, it's actually a traditional breakfast food in some, but not all areas of Japan. It was apparently invented by accident, as so many great things are, by some Japanese soldiers. They were boiling up soybeans to feed their horses. Soybeans were not considered to be people food. They were going to feed their horses. And then they were attacked by an invading army, so they threw their soybeans onto some hay, some straw, covered them up to hide them, I guess. And then they went into battle. When they came back a few days later, the beans that had been sitting in the straw under the sun, they'd all gone rotten. But that's all these guys had to eat. So they ate them. And the story gets a little fishy that apparently they liked them. Don't know about that. But then they brought some to the emperor, and he liked them, and he declared this to be breakfast. And it turns out that this is the single highest food in vitamin K2. One serving, which is very small, has a ton of vitamin K2. And they don't eat this everywhere in Japan, but they eat this in certain regions. And it turns out that the regions where they eat this, there is statistically significant correlation with lower rates of hip fracture, heart disease, even wrinkles. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And it makes a significant difference where they eat this and where they don't. The blood levels of K2 are higher, and all these health concerns are much lower. So yes, the Japanese have a reputation for being heart healthy and bone healthy, but it's the natto eaters that are propping up the reputation for the rest of the country. This one food makes a significant difference, and studies have shown you don't even have to eat it every day. If you eat it once in a while, once a week, twice a week, once every few weeks, you're doing better than not eating it at all, because it contains a special type of vitamin K2 that tends to last a long time in the blood. So that's pretty neat. You can see it's very versatile. She's eating this on toast here, and you can see the strings coming out of her mouth. I write in the book about my adventures of trying to find it in Toronto, and then trying to learn to eat it and like it. It's very, I mean, you just basically thaw it and put this, it comes with sauce, and you can eat it like that. I have a recipe in the book. It's an acquired taste, to say the least, that I have not yet acquired, but I'm still working on it. But the good news is that we can use natto to make a supplement. So for people who can't find it or can't come, anybody here are natto eaters? Have you tried it? Yeah, and do you like it?
Not really.
Not really,
okay. Did you get
it too?
Yeah, it's TNT.
TNT? TNT. Yeah. So yeah, I usually have to go to an Asian grocery, a well-stocked Asian grocery store, or a Japanese restaurant. Korean grocery stores often have it in stock.
How much K2 do you need?
How much K2? Good question. Actually, I'll talk about that. I'll get to that in a moment when we're talking about foods and supplements and how much you need. Let's see if we have time to talk about Weston Price. We'll skip through this. It's an interesting part of the history of this nutrient is the work of Weston Price, who was actually a dentist from Ontario, who traveled around the world to discover what made people healthy. And he found people all around the world back in the 1930s who didn't have toothbrushes or floss or toothpaste or dentists, and yet they maintained perfectly healthy teeth throughout their entire lifetime. And they also didn't get cancer, heart disease, diabetes, or all these other concerns. And to make a very long story short, it's an excellent big read here of medical anthropology. He found that these individuals had lots of fat-soluble vitamins in their diet, very high in vitamins A and D, and a third fat-soluble vitamin that he didn't know what it was, so he just called it factor X or activator X, and did quite a lot of research on this unknown nutrient and published it all under this name, factor X. And so for decades, this sat under the noses of researchers, didn't know what it was, and it was only a few years ago that we have been able to show that activator X is vitamin K2. So then it opens the door to all this other, all these other benefits that we're just beginning to understand about vitamin K2. I'll talk about these guys in a minute. So let's talk about, so a other benefits of vitamin K2, in addition to heart health and bone health, dental health, extremely important. And actually, I would have to say this is the one thing. You know, when people take a nutrient, sometimes you expect to see results or feel results. Well, the fact is you're not going to feel your bone density increasing. You're not going to feel your plaque being cleared out of your arteries. But the one thing people keep reporting to me, I get emails all the time, and I have to admit I experience the same thing, is vitamin K2 will help clean the plaque off your teeth. It just starts to crumble off your teeth. It's really kind of neat. And the plaque, of course, the health of the mouth reflects the health of the heart. There's been shown to be a correlation here between gum disease and heart health, for sure. So people write to me all the time about cleaning out their teeth. And very important for children as well, for preventing cavities in children and adolescents. Cancer prevention. I was astounded the amount of cancer research that was out there that hadn't been brought to light at all. But lung and prostate, so these are the two big cancer killers of men. K2 plays a very important role. Liver, so this is essential for anybody who has hepatitis to forestall the onset of liver cancer. Breast cancer, leukemia, the list goes on and on for cancer benefits. Diabetes, vitamin K2 has been shown to improve insulin sensitivity, so very important for diabetics. Varicose veins, calcium can accumulate in the walls of the veins in a similar fashion as it does in the arteries, and when that happens, the veins become distended and tortuous and hard. I haven't seen any clinical trials yet using this for varicose veins, but I've had a couple good cases of rather large bumpy varicose veins shrink down and disappear with vitamin K2. That's been a really good one. And if one thing comes out of this book, I hope it's that people will understand the importance of this nutrient for women who are pregnant. Vitamin K2 will control the facial development in the child, tooth development, bone development, has a number of effects on your health later in life. All throughout childhood, actually, lots of studies have been done, and adolescence, especially ages 12 to 15 when the hormones kick in and the skeleton starts to grow. It's a very important time for this nutrient. Studies have shown that adolescents tend to be the most vitamin K2 deficient group, and then menopausal women. And so this is a very important nutrient during those stages of life. And also, calcium can accumulate microscopically on the elastic tissues in the skin. And when that happens, the skin is not so elastic anymore, and that leads to wrinkles. So K2 has some anti-wrinkle activity, which we're all happy about that. I try not to mention that to the end so it doesn't cause a stampede as you all run out with your K2. So what have we got? Okay, so how much do we need to take to get these benefits? We'll talk about supplements and food a little bit. So as I was mentioning before, you can use natto to make a supplement. You culture up the natto, you extract the vitamin K2. It's like taking vitamin C out of an orange, and then you can put it in a supplement. So here we have Natural Factors has vitamin K2 on its own, or K with D. Like as I said, K and D work together, and so I prefer recommending them that way and taking them that way. But if you already have vitamin D at home, which lots of people do, then you can get K2 on its own. So this one has 100 micrograms, this one has 120, 100, 120, it's not a critical difference. Basically, one of these a day is a good maintenance dose for general health for adults and children. That's a good sort of all-around recommended dose. With children, we usually think because they're smaller, they need less, and studies have used smaller amounts, but although they're smaller, their bodies are growing, so they benefit from more because they have higher demands. If you have osteopenia, osteoporosis, diabetes, any kind of health concern really, then I would double that. Take two of these a day. That has been shown. Clinical trials for bone density use about 180 micrograms, which is approximately two of these a day. There's no toxicity associated with vitamin K2. It's extremely safe. It doesn't have, you've probably heard that other fat-soluble vitamins are potentially toxic. This one isn't because it works on a different mechanism. So that's good to know. To put these dosages in perspective, for individuals who are eating natto, one serving, just a little serving every day, they'd be getting the equivalent of 3 or 4 of these capsules per day. That's from one serving of natto. So you could be taking that much if you wanted. Certainly that's how much natto eaters are getting on a daily basis. There is no drug interaction with vitamin K2 except for warfarin. So warfarin blood thinners and warfarin type blood thinners, they work by blocking the body's recycling of vitamin K. And so if you are on, anybody on a warfarin blood thinner? Oh, that's good. Okay. If you know anybody who is, it's worthwhile to pick up the book. There's a section about it in chapter 3 about how vitamin K2 actually helps those medications in small amounts work more predictably. I've had a couple of pharmacists actually tell me that they can recommend vitamin K2 and adjust the warfarin dose to get really good benefits, results like that. But anything else, aspirin, Plavix, Pradax, the new blood thinner, cholesterol meds, heart meds, none of that interferes with vitamin K2. It's only warfarin. Coumadin and warfarin are the same thing. Yes. Yeah.
Same
for K3.
Pardon me. Is there a problem with
K2 and 3? I'd have to check into K3, but I'm pretty sure. Yeah. Any kind of K with warfarin, you want to keep it in a specific range. Okay. For individuals who are looking for a calcium supplement, who would like to take a calcium supplement, so I necessarily recommend a calcium supplement to everybody all the time. I don't recommend that all women take a calcium supplement all the time just because. But certainly, if you have been diagnosed with osteopenia or osteoporosis, we know that calcium supplements will help. And so if you're in that situation, this one, Healthy Bone Factors, I think is a nice formula that has been overlooked because it only has 600 milligrams of calcium per daily dose. And, you know, we've been told to take double or triple that. But that is, you just don't need all that calcium. And the calcium, again, is not the most important thing here. But if you want calcium, this is a nice combo. It has also magnesium in it. We haven't even really talked about magnesium yet. And you know that calcium and magnesium, they're like night and day, left hand, right hand. They go together. K2, vitamin D3. So it's a nice sort of balanced combo for individuals who are looking for a calcium supplement. Also, the Natural Factors, a multi-factors line of multivitamins, they all have vitamin K2 in them. It's not the most you can get. You know, multivitamins, they just have smaller amounts of more nutrients. But these ones are safe for people on warfarin and Coumadin. So that's why I bring these up. Any good multivitamin should have some K2 in it, and these ones do. A glass of milk?
Like how much would you need to eat if you don't want to talk to you?
Good question. Okay, so I have a list of foods in the book. Milk typically has no vitamin K2 because milk here is usually grain-fed and there won't be any K2 in it. Cheese, well, it depends on cheese. So Gouda is very high. You only need really a relatively small piece of Gouda cheese once or twice a day, or a little bit more brie cheese once or twice a day, combined with a couple of egg yolks. But again, it depends on how those are produced. So for example, your average anemic store-bought pale egg yolk, you know, you've had the grass-fed egg yolks that have the lovely orange yolks, right? Those have 40 to 50 micrograms of vitamin K2. So just 2 of those eggs a day would be enough to maintain for good heart health. With a store-bought egg yolk, the grain-fed ones, the pale ones, those have about 10 micrograms. So you'd need to eat about a dozen eggs a day to get anywhere. So it depends on, it's hard to say what you need to eat because it depends on how it's been produced. But the cheeses are very predictable. So a relatively small piece of Gouda is a good idea. You can usually mix and match with some brie and some butter, and you'd have to look at the list in the book and kind of add it up. Yeah. Are there any other questions? Yes. Oh, these guys. Oh, right. Okay. So we love to hear about the latest super nutrient for sure, but the fact is no vitamin works in isolation. And that's true for vitamin K2. So I like to show these guys just as a reminder that the major fat-soluble vitamins do work together. So this here is vitamin D. Everybody knows vitamin D. He's very popular, gets a lot of good press. Seems like every single week there's a new study about the benefits of vitamin D. Everybody's taking him. It's all good news about vitamin D. He's the darling of the nutraceutical industry. Now here's vitamin A. Vitamin A is certainly more obscure. We're not really sure what vitamin A is doing down there or what his role is. He seems a little strange and definitely misunderstood. And strangely, with all the good press around vitamin D, there's been seen somehow nothing but bad press around vitamin A. Don't know why that is. One is not more helpful or harmful than the other. They just have different roles in the body. Sort of like the gas and the brakes. You need both in a car. You can't say one is better than the other. And you can see they absolutely need to be in balance. So with taking greater and greater amounts of D and at the same time avoiding A, and we don't have as much A in our diets. Like, you know, once upon a time, parents forced their kids to eat liver once a week. So we all got lots of vitamin A, but nobody does that anymore. So vitamin A is lacking, and that's going to get things out of balance. Now you can see that K2, he's entirely dependent on A and D, or he'll fall flat on his face. And so he absolutely needs those guys, and all of these work together. Now very soon, Natural Factors will be introducing a K, A, and D combo, which will be the best choice. But in the meantime, you want to look for making sure you have some vitamin A in your diet, and I list food sources of that as well. Yes?
Is there a no toxicity level for A and D?
There certainly are toxicity levels for A and D, but it turns out that the toxicity we associate with either A or D is when they're administered in isolation. So if you give enough D on its own, eventually you see some toxicity. If you give enough A on its own, you'll see toxicity. If you give A and D together, studies have shown, you never see toxicity when they're given together. So it's the toxicity of these nutrients is sort of an artifact. And when people ask, like, well, how much vitamin D is safe or how much vitamin A is safe, the answer is it depends. And it depends on the other nutrients. Yes?
A number of things. First, I read through
the Oh, good, thanks. Good.
You mentioned Dr. William Davis. Is he the Wheat Belly author?
Wheat Belly author, yes.
Very
yeah.
And then you touched on strontium. So
strontium, sure.
And the other one is fluoride.
The other one is, sorry, what?
Fluoride.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's a big one. Okay, so let's talk. Well, we'll talk about strontium because this is a nutrient that has been promoted for bone health. And I'm not an expert on strontium, but I have been to some conferences recently where they looked at it. Strontium is a nutrient that is incorporated into the bones and can improve bone density. And it has also been shown to reduce fracturing of the bones for up to 2 years. After 2 years of taking strontium, it's much like the osteoporosis meds. They seem to improve bone density and bone health for about 2 years. After that, when you continue taking them, either bone density may increase, but fractures also start to increase. So yes, bone density is going up, but bone health is starting to go down. So I'm okay with strontium for up to 2 years, osteoporosis meds for up to 2 years. We have to keep in mind that bone density is not the only determinant of bone health. We're really focused on bone density because we have a test to measure it. But there are other determinants of our bone health, aspects that can't be measured by a bone density test, microarchitecture, your history of falls, your history of fractures. So if you have low bone density, but you have fallen and not broken something, that is a very important factor in your bone health. So we can't just focus on bone density. So basically when it comes to strontium, helps bone health for about 2 years, and then after that we see bone health declining. Fluoride, that's another very big topic. I'm not a fan of fluoride. I have quite pronounced fluorosis of my own teeth from having grown up with too much fluoride in my diet. And that did my teeth no good. So I have a personal thing with fluoride. It's hard to be objective about it, but I'm not a big, it's somewhat like strontium. It has a place in bone, but it's been quite over-exaggerated what its true benefits are to our bone health and tooth health.
Did you say after 2 years, strontium is still helping
the density? Well, that's the thing about strontium. Yes, after 2 years, you still see the density of the bone increasing, but fractures start to increase too. So the bone health only improves for about 2 years. Then after that, bone density is still increasing, but bone health is actually starts to decline. So that's why I say 2 years only for strontium. Yeah. Right. Oh, okay. Right. So that's a good question. Yes, Weston Price studied MK4, but he studied naturally occurring MK4 that you'd find in eggs and butter and cheese and those things. Well, not cheese because that's different, but eggs and butter. The MK4 that we find in supplements is quite different. It's a synthetic form that is made in the laboratory, and there's been lots of studies to show that the MK4 supplements that you find on the shelves are helpful, but you need them in doses of, most of the studies use 45 milligrams. And in Canada, we can only get 120 micrograms. So if you're taking 120 micrograms and you should be taking 45,000 micrograms, it's not doing you a whole lot of good. So that's why I recommend MK7. So we're talking about, there's two different forms of vitamin K2 you'll find on your shelves. When I recommend for people to look for somewhere in the fine print, lucky number 7 on the bottle. That refers to the form of vitamin K2 that, as I mentioned before, comes from natto, has a number of benefits. It's natural. The MK4, it's, well, in Canada, it's almost impossible. Even in the States, it's hard to find it in those doses. They say to supplement with both types. Yeah, I do have people supplementing with both types, but I mean, based on the studies, the MK4 should only be helpful in really high doses. So, yeah. When the moms had vitamin K2 during pregnancy, the nice wide faces, and then when K2 is missing, it creates a more narrow facial form that typically the canines, they either come in front or behind. Those need to be corrected with braces or pulled out or whatever. The pictures are kind of neat. Yes. Not necessarily. Omega-3 eggs is usually they've given the chickens flax in their diet, so it's good, but it's not necessarily any higher in K2. Yeah. Not necessarily. Yeah, certain things, for example, you know, calcium, whether you put it in a capsule or a liquid, it's not any more water soluble. It just, the body needs to break down the capsule, but it can you do that quite readily. So I wouldn't necessarily say so. Yeah. Now, these are fat-soluble vitamins. Excuse me. So, you know, liquid, for example, vitamin D, it's in a fat-soluble vase. That's good. Some of these are in soft gel, so there's liquid inside, and it's in a fat base, so that's good. Otherwise, just take it with food. Yeah. Yes?
So just taking the bone fetus alone is enough?
Good question. No. So the Healthy Bone Factors contains 120 micrograms of vitamin K2 per daily dose. That's as much as Health Canada will allow us to have. For optimal bone health, I think you need a little bit more. So I would take this and say one extra K2 on top, or make sure that you've got some extra K2 in your diet. Yes, arterial plaque is quite reversible. Yeah, we've definitely seen that in studies. Yeah, lowers the calcium score. Yes?
Form of calcium, what's your opinion?
So there's a big debate on the best types of calcium, and part of that comes from the fact that, okay, when calcium didn't work as well for us as we thought, then we started to debate what's the right kind of calcium. There's calcium carbonate versus calcium citrate. There's lots of different types, and certainly there are differences. There are some differences between the absorption and bioavailability of the different types. I prefer citrate over carbonate. I prefer MCHA in general. I think that's probably one of the best forms of calcium. But we have to remember, at the end of the day, calcium is calcium, and the bigger difference is in the nutrients that moves it around. People often also ask about, when I make recommendations about calcium, how much you should take, like 600 is plenty, somebody will ask, well, is that elemental calcium? And that often comes from a place of, well, if I, you know, elemental, if I do the calculations and I know how much calcium I'm really getting. But even if you calculate it out, you don't know how much calcium is going to the right places. So I'm not as particular, but I do like microcrystalline hydroxyapatite. That's a nice. Oh, magnesium. Yeah, magnesium deficiency is quite common, and taking calcium without magnesium will exacerbate that. So I would say 1:1 calcium to magnesium, or no more than 2:1 at the maximum. Yeah. Yeah. Other questions? Yes. Oh. Oh, sorry, we've got two. One back here, and then a, yes. Oh, this is new research since the book came out. Vitamin K2 has been shown to be helpful with leg cramps, as well as VO2 max, so your oxygen capacity. That's for athletes as well as the average individual. So it helps with all of those concerns. Yeah, and helpful with leg cramps. Yeah.
So I have a problem.
Well, maybe you can ask, if you want to ask me after your specific concerns, please. Yeah, what medications you're on. Yeah.
Sorry about
that. Sure, that's okay. Yep.
Can you get the K2 from the organic eggs?
Can you get K2 from organic eggs?
Organic seed.
Maybe. So free range, we don't know exactly what that means. So that may just mean the chicken's not in a cage, which is good. It's nice for the chicken for sure. But unless the chicken is going outside, then, and in the grass, even, you know, if it's an open door policy and she could go outside, but she's not, that won't get any more. Same thing with organic. Typically organic just means the hen's food has not been sprayed, which is also better, but doesn't necessarily mean anything about K2. So it really has to be a grass-fed egg. But you know, for example, they've got here, we've got some Vita eggs. They put herbs, green herbs, in the chicken's diet. The Vita eggs typically have a lot more orange yolks. And so it doesn't necessarily, it just have to be out on the pasture, but just having something green in her diet will help. So the Vita eggs, for example, they've usually got the more orange yolks with higher, potentially higher K2 levels. Yeah. Okay. Yes. How many eggs can we eat a day, a week? I don't know, I'm not particular, I don't restrict egg intake, as many as you feel like. Yeah. So I hope that you can see, and this is really just a small snippet of the information that's in the book, that K2 is an important missing piece to the puzzle of a lot of really important and common health concerns. Health concerns that have become so common that we almost accept to a certain extent some of these concerns as, oh, just a part of aging, just a part of life, when we're no longer in a position to be able to see them as nutrient deficiencies. So we need to get back to the old-fashioned ways of farming and producing our food, but until that time that we get back on that track, then supplementation will be helpful for all of us. So are there any other general questions?
So in other words, like you said, cholesterol is not necessarily an indicator of heart disease, in the same way the doctor sends us for the bone density is not truly an indicator of osteoporosis, which shows, because I fell last year and I didn't break any bones.
That's good.
That I didn't break. And recently my dentist said, she said, oh, all my teeth, the bone, the thing looks good.
That's good. So yes, so bone density is a factor in bone health, but it's not the whole story. Cholesterol is a factor in heart health, but it's certainly not the whole story, even less so than bone density. And there are other things, you know, the health of your mouth, your history of fractures and things that are just as important. Yes?
When the calcium that you're getting rid of, because it's in a wrong place, it's being gotten rid of, is it going to your bones and teeth, or is it being...
It's being eliminated. So that's the thing. We would like to think, and it would seem to make sense that, well, if you're taking calcium out of here, you just stick it over there. But it doesn't really happen that way. And those guys I showed you before, the acrobats, so vitamin D helps us absorb calcium. K2 moves it around, and vitamin A helps guide it out of the body. So vitamin A has gotten a bad rap because it will remove calcium from the body, but the fact is when you're decalcifying your arteries, you need to get rid of that. So this is how calcium, basically this calcium cycle moves up in and around and out of the body in appropriate ways. So we basically get rid of the calcium that comes from the wrong places. That includes, as I said before, heel spurs, bone spurs, osteophytes. I've had lots of interesting results with all kinds of unusual, funky calcifications in the body. Audio Jungle.